thank God for him creating these children and God allowing him to create these children that is none other than Brother Bernal Jordan.
Yeah. kinds of women, my church, our church mother, my foster, who were all the saints of God, my own wife, Karen, who was the saint of God. I want to talk about something that's in the news before I open my sermon. Those who were Sunday school heard it, but they bear it repeating again. You heard about the shooting at the AME Church, the Emmanuel AME Church, in Charleston, South Carolina. As soon as I heard that the shooting was at a church in South Carolina, it piqued my memory about something that I wrote about, over 40 years ago when I was, that I wrote about and published in the Black Anime. It's about a man named Denmark Beasley. Denmark Beasley was a freedom fighter. He was able to buy his own freedom. He was a slave, but he bought his own freedom. But he was unable to buy the freedom of his wife and his children. So he organized what they call a revolt, what I call the revolution, to free his friends, his wife, and his children, and to he planned to leave the harbor in Charleston and take his family and other slave women down to the Caribbean islands where they could be free. The reason I mentioned him relative to that church where the shooting took place, and the news is not mentioning this, Denmark Beasley, a black freedom fighter, was one of the co-founders of the Emmanuel AME Church. When you hear the newscasters say, some have said it, that in the past year the church was burned down. The reason the church was burned down was because white racists were afraid that blacks would gather there again, as Denmark Beasley and Peter Boyes had done, in order to fight for their freedom. That church should stand for us as a symbol of the struggle for our freedom. More than that, the AME Church, African Methodist Episcopal Church, was started because white racists in Philadelphia did not want blacks to fully participate in the Methodist Church there. And so if somebody knows his first name, tell me, the man's last name was Allen, who became the first bishop of the African Methodist or AME Church. He founded that church so that black people could have a place to worship where they would be fully recognized. So that, and then again, I want to add this on. Maybe, but I'm not going to say maybe. Sometimes I'm political. People talk about, oh, how could such a thing happen in a church? Or how short our memories are. In 1963, a church was bombed and four little black girls were killed in a church with a bomb by a bomb set by a white racist. And one other little black girl had a right eye, vision in her right eye, lost. This society now is saying, oh, how can this happen in the church? There are H. Pratt Brown, we don't know who he is. He was another black freedom fighter. He said this, the most segregated hour in the United States began at 11 a.m. on Sunday morning. We have to learn our history, teach it to our children, know that the Emmanuel AME Church stands as a symbol for our fight for freedom. The telecasters are not going to tell you that because they don't want you to know that black men fought for their freedom. Denmark Beasley, Gabriel Prosser, Peter Boyes, Nat Turner, they don't talk about that, and maybe you don't even hear it in your American history classes. This is going to be my sermon. I'm going to close. I don't talk much about it today. I am going to talk about it today. Here on Sunday. Why don't they teach that to us? Because they want us to think that we were docile and happy and slave. And we just dance and sing songs. That's not true. We fought for our freedom just like other people have fought for theirs, but that part of our history is not given to us in the history books that you get in school. That's why we as a church, in addition to leading people to Christ, are going to have to lead our young men and young ladies to know that the fight for struggle continues. We have to continue to fight for our freedom. If people are acting like something that happened in a church, Wednesday is something new. It's not new. Black churches were burned during the civil rights movement. And the one that I talked about when I said nine people killed in a church, four little girls all under the age of 13 killed in a church bombing by white racists. We have to start raising our children to be strong. I mentioned Peter Poitras for a reason. He was a part of Denmark Beasley's group who were going to fight for their freedom in Charleston. Peter argues with one of the leaders, and here's what he said to the men after they were captured. And you want to hear this, or read about this in our so-called history books. He told the men when they were captured, don't say a word. Don't you cry out. Don't you let out a sound. He said, when it's time for us to be hanged, he said, let me be hung first so I can show the rest of you how to die like a man. You won't read that anywhere, but that was a black man saying, I'm too proud to cry to anybody for my freedom. I fought for it, and I'm not going to cry when you hang me because I stood up on the ground. Let me tell you, we have to teach this to our children. That's why we have to, and I'm praying that God is trying to get back here so, into the Carson area. So we can start teaching our children who you are, where you came from. You think you came from Stephen Fletcher and then came home? No, you came from strong men who fought for their freedom, who said, give me liberty or give me death. It wasn't just said by some white man today. The British, they tell us, be not silent. Don't fight back. I'm not. We have a right to fight for freedom, fight for self-defense. If it's not right to fight back when you're being oppressed, then why don't we send the Peace Corps to Afghanistan and Iraq? Can I get a witness? They tell you, don't fight, everything's going to be okay. How did this country become free as we thought? They fought a rebellion against the established authority, the Europe, the Englishmen, to say we're going to take this country, we're not going to take mistreatment, so we as white people are going to fight for our freedom, but they want us to just kneel down and bow down and pray. Yes, there's a time to kneel down. There's a time to pray. But we as black men are going to learn to stand up, and the first thing we have to do learn to defend our family. People think they can walk for black women anywhere they see, and black men don't come to their rescue. Then what I tell you, what do you think would happen if any one of us black men would attack a Mexican woman out there on the road? How many Mexican men do you think would come to that woman's assistance? Not even no longer the problem. All they would see, I know y'all say, oh, Pastor, this ain't for church. Yes, it is. This is the truth. Every Mexican man passing by would stop and find out what he was like in Mexico. What do we do when it happens to our women? You said, man. Drive right on by and say, I want to push you along. It's time for us to stand up. Jesus did not make us cowards. Jesus was the strongest man, the toughest man that ever lived. And he told his followers, sell your coat and buy yourself a suit, because I'm sending you out among raging wolves. The Bible says in Psalms 91 and 1, blessed be the Lord my strength, which teaches my arms to war and my fingers to fight. I'm not advocating being violent for no reason at all, but you have a right to fight for your self-defense. You have a right to defend anybody that you see being done wrong. And you absolutely have a right to stand up as a man and represent yourself. How can we call ourselves somebody? And I'm talking to say this on Father's Day because black men need to know this. And black women. How can we call ourselves fathers if we don't defend our families? That's a part of a job, a father's job. That's a part of a man's job, to defend the women of his race. No matter what she's done wrong, you can't stand by and fight somebody else. Well, I don't understand anything. That's what this is from the man.
Right.
defend yourself, learn to defend your rights. Now, there's a time, let me give you something. Okay. When you're up against a police officer, and he has a gun and a badge, that's the time for you to be not an honorable tongue, but a functional tongue. You got to say, yes, sir, officer. No, sir, officer. Yes, sir, officer, number 35972. No, sir, officer, 35972. You got this. You have to represent yourself in this way. That is not the time to fight. I never saw, in the year that I was in Vietnam, I never saw a Viet Cong throw a power sign. But they defeated the United States. Why? Because they cooked our food. They shined our shoes. They pressed our clothes. But they didn't say that they were VC. They said VC number 10, G.I. You number one. I like you, G.I. But you know what they were saying? Let me find out where you live. Let me find out where all of you live. Because one time it may be necessary for me to come into your room and cut your throat. That's just a fact, though. I'm not advocating that. But how did a little country like Vietnam defeat the United States? They didn't throw a power sign. They didn't have guns. They didn't have prayer. They just stood up and talked to their friends. They said, here, let me give you something. I'll give you a few more minutes. When you are fighting to protect your home, you will fight a lot harder than the person you're trying to invade your home. Because you've got nowhere else to go. That's why the Vietnam War is here. That's why the people in America are fighting the way they are. Let me give you something. They said, we can't train. I'm getting you. I don't care whether I'm fighting or not. I'm back. I'm back. They said, we can't train the Iraqis to fight. What's the problem? ISIS are Iraqis. They're fighting for their home. Yeah. It's not that you can't train the Iraqis to fight. The Iraqis are saying, go home, G.I. The only ones that want you to stay there are those who are political power, who are being paid by the United States to hold the power that they have to be friendly to the United States and the world. That's why we're, don't tell me the Iraqis can't fight. ISIS and Al-Qaeda are Iraqis. The same thing they say about the Vietnamese. We can't get the Vietnamese to fight. Well, who are you fighting against? Vietnamese. The North Vietnamese. Can I get a witness?
Yeah.
What y'all understand is, now fathers today, we as fathers have to pass this on to our children. And we can't let somebody else of another ethnicity determine what our children think. We need to teach them what they need to know about who they are and where they came from. Why?